Hello, this is Travis Ritchie. I play Inspector Spacetime, and you're listening to Mark Who 42.
So Mark Who 42's universe here on the Subspace Radio Network, Florida Geek Scene, Geekcast Radio Network, and all around the interweb thingy, including our website, markwho42.com. And welcome to all our new listeners on Stitcher Radio and TuneIn Radio. We welcome you and hope that you listen to us for the rest of life, because we're great. We are the meaning of life. We're 42. I'm your host, Mark Baumgarten, and with me today are...
Eduardo M. Freyre, and so far I haven't been canceled by the new higher-ups at Warner Brothers Discovery.
That's saying something, isn't it? That's saying something, and we'll get to that later in the show, soon in the show. We also have...
Vicky Jakubowski.
Hi, Vicky.
Hi.
What's going on?
Nothing much. Just thinking about ways to end my Discovery Plus membership and tell them they're not going to care about my $4.99. Mm-hmm. But still, I'd like to.
And we also have
Zion Quiros.
Hey, Zion.
Hi.
Do you have HBO Max?
Yeah, and I was actually enjoying it until like 2 weeks ago or so.
You know, it's funny.
I
have HBO Max, and I'm getting it. Supposedly I'm still getting it free because it's still being given you from AT&T, but I don't see how, because AT&T doesn't own it anymore, so technically they may be charging us and we just don't know. It may be ending in our household quicker than we thought. So as you can hear, we're dissing Discovery Network and HBO Max. Well, we're not dissing HBO Max. We're sad about HBO Max. And we're talking about how Discovery Networks has decided to trash all the programming on HBO Max and DC Universe properties. It really sucks. And to talk about it, we've got someone who can tell us right from wrong. It's Ed. Ed.
Well, Ed. Okay. Stop.
Okay.
Stop.
I thought you were going to make a joke, so I tried to preempt it. Okay.
Yeah, you just made things worse, dude.
I keep doing that today. It's not good.
Yes, you do. Yes.
It's too ungodly early.
Yeah, they're doing it very early in the morning. We're doing it at lunch. I haven't eaten lunch yet. I'm hungry, and when I don't eat, I go loopy.
Yeah, so. I did this straight from waking up, so you know I haven't had breakfast. You didn't supply breakfast.
There's no coffee in the green room.
Sad. Yeah, rude. We're gonna have to discuss this. We're gonna have to sit down. You're gonna have to like supply me with some coffee and toast, things like that.
How about donuts?
Intravenous
caffeine.
No, I'm trying to. Wait a minute! I'm like donuts. I'm trying to eat healthy, and you're like, "Yo, what about donuts? What
coffee and donuts sound good?
Coffee and dude, I'm trying to be healthier."
Okay, you know what?
I love donuts, but come on.
Yeah, we're totally off subject. Sorry, folks. If you're listening to us on Stitcher, we do this all the time, but we get to the meat of the story, and we're gonna do that now.
I have to admit, I think part of me is dodging it because I'm still trying to find out how to, figure out, how do I say this without, just losing my my mind here.
I certainly haven't been describing it in the most non-filthy way.
Yeah, no,
yeah,
well,
we have to hit this panic button on this a couple of times and
nope,
edit
nope,
this.
Nope, yeah. I'm going to be good here.
Okay, who's the... See, I forgot his name because I've been referring to him with I've been referring to him with descriptions like jerk and
those other words
like,
we shall not say.
Yes. What is the name of the guy from Discovery who's now in charge?
David Zaslav.
Zaslav.
Doesn't it
okay.
sound like a DC Zaslav. Kind of like supervillain
yeah,
or something?
He
it does.
Like
actually,
Batman,
it does.
It sounds like
it
one
does.
Of Batman's villains. One
yes,
of,
yeah, it
or,
does. I'm
no,
not,
or,
mm. Just call him Zaslav.
Yeah, or either,
Victor
either a bat. Yeah, either yes. a either a Batman villain or just, you know, any sort of like, you know, top spy hench type of
yeah.
Type
yeah.
of character. You know, it's.
I feel
it's
like he's never seen a movie he's liked. I mean, this is the man who brings you 90 Day Fiancé. Well, what the hell does he know about movies and DC?
Yeah, no, I my thing is that, okay, so, you know, I think we should get into a little bit of background.
Yeah, please.
The thing, okay, you know, Discovery, the Discovery, mm-hmm. you know, Discovery bought Warner Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
They, you know, they basically plan to merge the, you know, the two things. It seems, you know, mm-hmm. it does seem like there's supposed to be some sort of plan involving Discovery Plus versus, you know, Discovery Plus versus HBO Max. But the thing is that one of the first things that, you know, Zaslav did is he started slashing and burning.
Yeah.
I know that there are episodes of Sesame, there's stuff on that was on HBO Max that is gone now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there was and then also, yeah, one of the biggest ones to come out, one of the ones that's really set people in like total anger, is the Batgirl movie. It got canceled.
Yeah.
Well, he gave 68 different reasons why he did it.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And
well,
some
the,
of
well,
them
the biggest,
contradicted each other.
Well, the biggest, the one that seems to keep showing up is that they basically, you know, supposedly, well, first of all, this film was cost $90 million.
So
which
far,
is
cheap. So yeah, far, is, it was going to cost more if they kept going.
Okay, but it's like, you know, so far we're at 90 million. It's pretty much almost done.
Yeah.
I think there were a couple of things that had to be shot and, you know, also some.
There was a couple of,
a couple of post-production
things. And then there
would have
been ad campaigns, so it would have.
Right.
Would've
well, but here's the thing. I mean,
but it still
it's 90.
Been cheap.
Yeah, it's $90 million, but supposedly so. So one of the vague, this is where I really lose it, because it's like you have all this vague reasoning that
yep.
what he, you know, the plan is, oh, we've got to be, you know, these have to be like cinema worthy, you know, tentpole, you know, big blockbusters. And apparently Batgirl was not, which to me, I look at that and my first question is, this was $90 million. So you're telling me you spent $90 million and it's not cinematic enough. And I'm just
their
like,
fault.
What are you? Okay. But I'm just yeah. like, what are you? And then.
But it also costs too much. So they can't put it on HBO Max.
Right.
It costs
and
too
it's,
little to go out onto the theaters, but it costs too much to put it on streaming. What
yeah, which,
kind of philosophy is that?
Yeah, I mean, it's
put
just,
some more money in it, redo the effects, and put it in the theater.
Well, see, and that's the thing, because it's like, okay, supposedly, now here's where I here's another thing where I'm kind of like, because supposedly there was a test screening that did not go very well, and I
well, that's
just have
what they keep saying, but then I've also heard from some of the people who were at the test screening, they've come out and said, no, it just, you know, there were just some things that we suggested that need to be fixed. You know, kind of like every film has those
yeah.
people go, well,
yeah,
maybe
I,
this, maybe that. It wasn't going to bomb and sink like the Titanic.
Right. Yeah. I know? Think I kind of wonder also, like, see, because this is what I kind of wonder, because so if, you know, the way that it didn't go so well, I kind of wonder, is it not because, you know, it's not so much that things had to be fixed so much that it didn't, it's not so much things had to be fixed. It's that for some reason, our friend, you know, our friend, Mr. Zoloft, or yeah, you know what? I probably should care more, but
I liked that name. So
that was a good one.
I should probably care more about saying his name right, but you
Victor
know what?
Zsasz.
Victor Zsasz, I don't know, Mr. I carve my victims into my skin.
His name is close to Zsasz.
But yeah, I kind of feel like he had this thing in his head, like he and whatever, you know, whatever minions he has, they have this thing in their head about how they wanted, you know, how they wanted this to go. And when it didn't come out that way, that now it's like, oh, okay, well, you know, it must be something wrong with it and we can't release it.
You know, I just, the problem with movie studios in general, that they don't like to take risks and that they don't like to, that's why you have to have independence and you have to have people shooting stuff in their backyard, because a lot of companies don't want to take risks. And his thought process, and again, I really want to know what his qualifications to say what is a good movie and what is not. If he wants everything to be end game money, you're not going to get that. Even Marvel doesn't get that.
No.
Well, the other thing is that you want, you know, it's, you know, ever since the DCEU was a thing.
Yeah.
They've been trying to chase Marvel.
Yes.
And the thing is that it's not paying attention to what the Marvel formula is.
Right. It's a cheap version of, oh, well, Marvel did this, so we should do that. That's not what made it good. That's
jumping into Justice League because they wanted to take on the Avengers.
Yes.
Instead of slowly building. I mean, if they wanted to do Marvel, slowly build. Don't just jump into the biggest moneymaker, which I guess they were trying to do.
Well, even then, it's like, you know, part of, well, this is part of the thing as far as, you know, as far as what we're talking about, they don't want to take risks. If you look, okay, one of the blessings in disguise about not having access to X-Men, not having access to Spider-Man or the Fantastic Four, is that they had to get creative.
Yeah.
You know, I can't help but think, you know, if they had had access to Spider-Man, if they had, you know, we wouldn't have gotten Ant-Man.
No.
If they had access to Fantastic Four, we would not have gotten access to Guardians. We would have gotten
Guardians.
The
Guardians.
They would have, you know, they would have gone with, they would have been like, okay, no, we're going to do the expected.
Yes.
Because, you know, not having access to these things made them get creative. You know, it's great. You know, I mean, okay, kudos to DC and Warner Brothers to the fact that they didn't have the bankruptcy problems that Marvel had that forced them to like sell off the rights to their stuff.
Yeah.
You know, in doing something like, you know, movies and TV. Like, that's great. Good for you. The thing is that this has then, this has kind of made a problem, you know, part of the problem is, what's going to happen is the powers that be are going to be like, well, no, we don't have to do Blue Beetle. We'll just do this. Their whole thing is, they don't have to do, they don't have to do Blue Beetle. They don't have to do, they don't have to do this. They just know that, well, we have Batman. Batman's always popular. We're going to do Batman.
But like, even then, right, you could even argue that in certain aspects, DC has already won. Like in their animated circuit, they overshadow Marvel and it's not even close.
Yes, but Mr. Zazzy's canceling those in the future.
exactly.
Well, yeah,
that's the problem.
We are calling Mr. Zsasz for now on.
Yes.
Yeah.
But
Mr., you know,
Zion, that is like the most profitable and popular aspect of DC. You are exactly correct. But this guy wants to cancel them going forward. He doesn't see the advantage in keeping that side of DC.
Yeah, there was a new show called Strange Adventures, which they were developing, and I know Kevin Smith had an episode, and yes. It was basically taking obscure, unused characters and putting them in a story, and it was an anthology. They were going to spend several, a lot of $1 million per episode to make it look cinematic, like this Batgirl seems not to have been. And, you know, so they're going to have something that looks really good. Thank you, Mr. Zsasz, Victor. And, you know, they take it off saying, oh, it's not going to make us money or anything. And in my mind, why? That actually.
Yeah, I mean,
you're saying no
those
cinematic.
Those videos fly off the shelf.
Yeah,
people
you'd
watch
sell a lot
them
of
on
videos.
HBO Max. My son has the entire collection.
Yeah.
And every 6 months when a new one comes out, it's like, ooh, ooh. Must have. Oh, look, they now have two of them. Ooh, I must get the
yeah.
set.
Yeah.
So,
no, well,
you know, they're very profitable.
Yeah.
Well, and the other thing, you look at, yeah, I mean, here's the thing. Another thing that got taken down was there was going to be a Batman cartoon.
Yeah.
I mean, I know I'm ragging on Batman, but you know,
what else
out.
Can we rag on? That's the big part of it.
Well, yeah, here's the thing. There was going to be a new Batman cartoon called The Caped Crusader that one of the brains behind it was Bruce Timm.
Yeah.
Okay, if that name should sound familiar.
J.J. Abrams, too?
I think J.J. Yeah. was involved, too. But here's the thing. The thing that should have fans going, wait a minute. It was Bruce Timm, who was responsible for Batman the Animated Series,
yeah,
which, to this day. Oh yeah, no, see, it's iconic. It you know, and it has one of the most iconic renditions of Batman and the Joker, and not to mention that it started an entire universe. It started like a bunch of shows, you know, not just Batman, but we also had Superman, Batman Beyond, iterations of Justice League.
Yeah.
So it's like, wait a minute, you know, this is, if anything should be saved from the chopping block, it should be this, because Bruce Timm, especially when the bat is concerned, that's a proven success story.
Yeah.
You know,
especially
and yet,
like when you look at this one bit of art we have, like we don't see Golden Age Batman often. Let alone an animated version. So this is like a literal stab to the heart.
Oh yes. Yeah, no. The other thing that gets me. I mean, this is Bruce, and it's like the other one that gets me. Okay, so far, you know, who knows? Maybe you know, who knows that maybe this will you know, this will turn out right. But the cartoon Young Justice. Just had its fourth season. Okay, it just had it, and already, you know, the last thing I heard is that nobody's talking about season five.
Yep.
Nobody's talking about doing a season. They're like, you know, and here's the thing. When I first, you know, I've only been recent to Twitter. You know, I got there like, I think it was sometime around 2015, maybe. Mm. Here's the thing though. One of the first things I did when I got to Twitter was I was a part of, you know, I was one of those that was using the hashtag Renew Young Justice, Bring Back Young Justice, because that show had a fan base. Like, here's the thing. You want to sit there and you want to, you know, bow before the, you know, the fans of Zack Snyder. About, oh, you got the Snyder Cut made. Hey, before that, there was those of us, you know, Young Justice fans that were like, Renew Young Justice, Save Young Justice. And we got, you know, we got it brought back. The reason that we had two seasons on HBO was because of us. And by the way, we did it without, like, ragging on other people.
Yeah.
Just to say, you know, we weren't like, this sucks. Let's bring back Young Justice. No, we were like, it's a cool show. We want to see it.
you know, really have to question his taste because he keeps slashing things like the CW Arrow. Let's see what we got: Arrow, Flash, Legends of Tomorrow, and Supergirl. Did I miss one? But all of those, they're going to kill them off. Some of them early. Some of them, I think Arrow already ended.
Well, yeah,
Arrow, I'm 2 seasons behind, so I got to catch up.
Arrow. I know Arrow ended 2019. You know, like the 2019-2020 season, it ended. You know, basically, Crisis on Infinite Earths was Arrow's swan song. Supergirl ended like a season or two ago, but Batwoman, Legends of Tomorrow,
yes,
they got canceled.
I know, my son was like, why haven't you watched Batwoman yet? I'm like, I haven't had time.
Yeah,
like, now I gotta watch it before they remove it from all of availability.
Yeah,
because he doesn't understand why they're good.
Yeah, also, you know, also the other one is the Flash I think is just ending. Like, yeah. I don't think it's
they're
canceled.
Not getting that. Well, I think that it's ending earlier than it planned, because I did hear that there was some surprise by the cast that they weren't doing the final thing that they were supposed to be doing. It's just ending.
They're gonna, so far the only stuff left is Superman and Lois, which apparently may or may not be part of the main Arrowverse. Like, they're now.
No, but I think it's on the chopping block because he doesn't seem to understand the advantage of the TV shows, even though they bring in viewers to
There's
the
also,
other thing.
Didn't he say that TV shows, he only wants to concentrate on the blockbuster movies because he wants to do what Marvel does, and so he doesn't want to do the TV shows that are
even though Marvel has
Marvel,
how many TV shows out?
They do TV shows and they're successful. How does he? Because you know what?
Yeah.
He doesn't like DC Comics. He doesn't like DC properties.
Or, you know, he doesn't
he's making up excuses. He just wants to get rid of DC. Who knows if the comic company is going to stay? If it's so,
well, I don't. Okay, I don't. Okay, I don't think. Well, I will say this. I don't think he's really trying to dunk DC. I don't think that he's trying to, like, you know.
I don't think he knows what he's doing.
I don't think. Yeah, I think what it. Maybe. I mean, well, with the TV shows, that one thing I'm worried. I know that Stargirl.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
Is come. You know, Stargirl does have its third season coming.
Well, so does Titans and Doom Patrol.
Yeah, but we'll see. You know,
but
we'll see what happens.
Already.
Yeah, yeah, they're made art, but we'll see. Like, if these upcoming seasons are it. Or, you know, if they'll keep going. It just, it feels to me, you know, the vibe I'm getting is that he, you know, whether it's just, you know, whether it's just Mr. Zoobly Zoo, or, you know, it's him and a few minions, just don't understand, like, what is, you know, what it is that they need to do, because it was just brought up, you know, it's let's focus more on having, you know, these big cinematic things, and it's like, dude, if you want to dethrone Marvel, if you want to dethrone the MCU, you gotta look at what they're doing, you know, what did they do right, and TV is a part of it. Once they were able, you know, once Disney Plus came on and they were able to do their own shows, they have been killing it out of the gate. And, you know, it's not, you know, and yeah, some of these shows haven't been, you know, these big budget spectaculars. You know, WandaVision, the first two episodes, you know, the first few episodes are not that, you know, big and cinematic. You know, it was very experimental. And they did focus on some obscure stuff.
And you know what? I hate to interrupt here, but we have to focus on some obscure stuff too. We have to take a commercial break.
You know what? I'll take advantage of that, get some water, and try to, like, you know, do a little namaste, because I need to take a breath or two, lest I, you know, start saying some unhappy kidding on friendly words.
Okay, so you're listening to Mark. Listening to Mark Who 42's Universe on Subspace Radio Network, Florida Geek Scene, Geekcast Radio Network, iTunes, Google Play, Audible, Spreaker, Spotify, Stitcher Radio, TuneIn, iHeartRadio, and most other podcast platforms, or at markwho42.com. We'll be right back.
Are we also available via carrier pigeon?
Maybe.
Don't go away. We'll be back with more Mark Who 42 after this.
Because the world needs another movie podcast.
The Geekcast Radio Network presents for your listening pleasure, The Cinema Geek.
Hosted by Amanda, Kevin, Matt, and Dan.
Each week we dive headfirst in the landscape of movies as we discuss movie news,
play movie games,
go in-depth on reviews,
and even have a top 10 countdown or two.
Also, don't miss our director retrospective series, where we review noted directors' movies film by film.
Bottom line is, if you love movies and love podcasts, you need to experience The Cinema Geeks.
You can find us on iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, or geekcastradio.com.
You are listening to Mark Who 42's Universe.
Welcome back to more of Mark Who 42's Universe here on Subspace Radio Network. We're also on most other podcast platforms like Stitcher, iHeartRadio, Google Play, and we're also hosted by Florida Geek Scene and Geekcast Radio Network, along with our own flagship website, markwho42.com. We are talking about how Discovery Networks is totally destroying HBO Max and DC. That's my opinion. I don't know if it's everyone else's. My name is Mark Baumgarten. With me are Eduardo M. Freyre, Vicky Jakubowski, and Zion Quiros. So, guys, he's not just taking apart DC, is he? I mean, Sesame Street.
Right. Well, yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, I will pick up from what you said in the end, you know, when we came back from commercial. I don't blame Discovery.
Do you blame, Discovery? Zaslav?
I blame, you know, David
Zaslav.
You know, David Zookeeper or whatever.
Okay, Zookeeper goes for it.
Yeah, no. I'll go with Zookeeper.
Well, I'd like to point out that
David Zucchini. I don't know.
Oh God, no. But you know, when you look at the quality of Discovery owned properties over the years. And that's things like the Food Network, History Channel, HGTV, DIY, the Learning Channel, Discovery Channel. I remember when the History Channel actually had historical shows, and they were good. They didn't get hosted by guys with wild hair talking about ancient aliens. I remember when Shark Week was about sharks. This year's top fair was Jackass versus Sharks.
Are you serious?
That was the theme of 2.0, because apparently there was an earlier one.
Oh, Lord.
So the quality of what they give us, because I actually, even before this happened, was getting ready to cancel my Discovery Plus membership because I just didn't watch it enough. It didn't have any new shows. I was watching old shows. And it's kind of like, okay, it's not really worth it for me to keep it. And now they're saying that they're going to combine them and probably, what do they call the new comfrey? Something like Discovery HBO. And they're going to combine the streaming members, which is something like 92 million. And of course, most of them subscribe to HBO Max, not Discovery. So that's the only way these Discovery shows are going to get the viewers that they want. So it's kind of like they don't know what they're doing. And the management from the top down is making some very poor choices in what they already give us. And now they're going to take HBO, which I'm sorry, has Warner Brothers. Mm-hmm. And Warner Brothers, you know, to me, Warner Brothers is the studio of two Polish immigrant boys who brought us Errol Flynn and Olivia de Havilland and, you know, Henry Ford and James Cagney. And then, of course, in later years, they brought us all the DC movies that we actually liked. And, you know, what are they going to do?
Well, like, I see it like this. It can go two ways. Either A, they double down and stick with this. Or two, they make a U-turn. Because if you look at everything that's been canceled it's not really canceled. Most of the stuff is still being made in production. It's just trying to find a different home. Like Batman Cape Crusaders is not canceled. It's just trying to find a different place that's not HBO Max. Now, when that happens, this is what's going to happen. Everyone's going to say, hey, Batman Crusaders out. Let's go over there and watch it. And goes over there and watches it.
Well, and but here's the problem. Warner Brothers owns the rights, and Warner Brothers now belongs to Discovery.
Yes.
So what they're going to allow them to shop out, still going to control.
If it does get out and does such, this is what's going to happen. They're going to look at it, and no matter what, either they like it or not, it could say, hey, those guys are getting much more viewers because we didn't have Batman, but they do.
So, well, like, if we're lucky, David will be fired, and we'll get somebody who cares. And is smart, you know, business. If you
you
can't just buy companies to become rich, although some people have, that's all they do is they buy them and dismantle them. But well,
that's,
you know,
that's what kind of happened with Toys R Us. You know, it got bought out and dismantled.
Yeah.
You know,
you
I think
do that with entertainment. That's just silly.
Yeah. I think
mean, silly any other way too. But.
What I'm thinking. Okay, this is kind of what I'm thinking. Okay, this is what I see in my head. So they try to merge everything. You know, they try to merge the two, and have the Discover. You know, the Discovery Plus stuff on HBO Max to try to like get some of that HBO Max love. You know, for their stuff. But what's going to happen is the stuff on HBO Max is going to keep getting views. You know, the stuff that was originally HBO Max, the Discovery stuff is not. And instead of learning the lesson from it, what is going to happen is they're going to take the, you know, the powers that be are going to take the wrong lesson. They're going to be like, oh, well, you know, this was just, you know, why didn't this work? It's because we didn't have this, you know. And they're not gonna be trying to like course correct. They're gonna be instead picking something and doubling down on it,
right?
Saying, you know, oh no, well it's because we didn't have this, you know. You know what's gonna happen is, I wouldn't be surprised if they do allow them to shop around, but there would be some sabotage going on. You know, where it's like, oh, sure, you can have it on Hulu, but it's going to be once a week, and you know, it'll only be available for whatchamacallit, something like, you know, 6 months and then disappear. You know, it's going to be that kind of thing. It's going to be something where it's going to be very limited. It's going to be very limited in just how. And, you know, I also kind of see where, they will probably try to double down on, you know, trying to get the quote-unquote popular people in films. But if they don't get, like, the right talent.
I don't know what they think the crossover is going to be when you've got some of their most, some of their biggest viewed shows are shows that are no longer on the air, like Mythbusters. Yeah. But it's also shows... Well, like the aforementioned Shark Week, but they've got things like, you know, Naked and Afraid 10. I'm looking at their list of their biggest shows: Deadly Women, Street Outlaws, Man versus Wild. You know, and a whole bunch of shows that have not been on for 10 plus years because there's people are watching the old shows when it was good.
Yeah.
You're not going to have people who are into Game of Thrones or Westworld or DC naturally gravitate over to Ancient Aliens and 90 Day Fiancé and some of these other shows that every time I open it up, it's like, don't you want to watch this? No.
No.
Yeah. Well, no. Also, well, it's also like, I'm trying to, I'm going to take a page from somebody else. You know, I'm going to take a page from the Mouse House or, you know, stuff. And related to the Mouse House in the sense of, look at what happened with the movie Morbius.
Yeah.
It tanked.
Yeah.
It did horrible. And it inspired a meme on the internet.
Yep.
And then somebody, you know, somebody thought, oh, it inspired an internet meme. I'm sure if we re-release it in theaters, it'll do blockbuster. And it did not.
No.
It crashed and burned again.
Yeah.
Because it's one of those things where, congratulations, you didn't pay attention. The reason why it's so popular is because people are making, you know, it's
interesting.
Well, it's the reason why Morbius seems so popular is because people were making fun of it. Okay.
Don't do what Morbius did.
Yeah. Don't do it. You know, it feels kind of similar. What I'm detecting here is kind of similar in the sense that they're like, oh, well, you know, all this stuff is awesome on HBO Max. Well, I'm sure that, you know, the Game of Thrones, you know, everybody's going to all about the sex and violence of Game of Thrones. So maybe they'll go with Bridezilla's Gone Deadly.
You know?
Yes! It's just like Game of Thrones!
That's exactly what's on my search list.
Yeah, you know, it's exactly like Game of Thrones. Sex and violence. See, kids? We're cool!
Well, one of the things that HBO Max has that makes it so great is that every single person in my family has something that they like about it. Not everyone's into Game of Thrones. That's okay.
Yeah,
not. I never got into it. I know. Don't hit me.
No, I never did either. Don't worry. Don't worry. We're both
awesome. You know what? So much I watch on there between their animation, their Turner Classic Movie library, which is a lot of early Warner Brothers and some MGM. And I love the old movies. And then there's the DC stuff that they offer that, I mean, it's just high quality. Some of the stuff that's coming out, and I'm always pleasantly surprised. And then I got to tell you, HBO's documentaries are one of the best company making documentaries right now.
Yeah, I agree.
And they encourage new talent. I've actually spent entire days with documentaries playing, and it's just so good and so thought-provoking, and nobody's got crazy hair and telling you to use a car.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with crazy hair.
Yeah, well, look at the mini series that are available on HBO Max. Stuff like Band of Brothers.
Yeah.
You know, which has that, it's a mini series, it's based off real events. But you look at it and it's like, you know, you look at Band of Brothers, there's also a documentary which features the same, you know, the same real people that this is based off of. It is
amazing.
You know, it's amazing. And yeah, nobody with crazy hair, you know, nobody, you know, nobody with a ton of tattoos and a America, hell yeah. You know, it's these quiet, you know, you look at the actual soldiers and when they recorded this, it's these older guys who are just very quiet, very soft-spoken. It, you know, you have, also HBO. I mean, they had, you know, think of the shows, like, for example, there's also Boardwalk Empire, which was really good.
Oh, yeah, I love Boardwalk Empire.
So many different areas.
Yeah, and, you know. I got to be honest, there is a part of me, I mean, okay, I will admit that back in the day, I did make fun of the History Channel, you know, me and mine, that we did make fun of the History Channel, that it should be called the Hitler Channel, because it seems it's all the Nazi documentaries. It's like, you know, it's silverware of the Third Reich.
You learned.
Okay. That was kind of starting up about the same time that they started getting into the more out there sort of stuff. And I have no problem with a couple of paranormal documentaries. I got no problem with that at all. But when it became less about history, less about facts, you know, when they released the Megalodon is real with the worst CGI in the world, and then they said, oh no, it was a mock documentary. It wasn't meant to be a documentary.
I didn't know that. All right. They fooled me.
Or then, you know, they go, Ancient Aliens, where you have the wild, you know, the guy with the wild hair. And it's like, according to ancient alien researchers,
ancient astronaut theorists suggest.
Yeah. And it's like, it's one of those things where I'm just like, I've known teachers that if you call yourself an ancient astronaut theorist, they will be like, what is this? What have you put in? What garbage have you put in front of me, sir?
Oh, do you think that guy might be related to David Zazzy? Maybe?
David Zsasz hands?
Zsasz hands! Okay, we're having too much fun with his name.
You know what? Probably, but I'm just so mad right now, I don't care.
Well, it's cleaner than what we really want to say, so he can deal.
Yeah, that is true.
You know what I'm thinking of, really? That like, I really see what is the end game coming. Like if you step back and you look at the DCEU, right?
Yeah.
As we said, they was trying to copy Marvel, right?
Yeah.
And so we get just leaked the first Suicide Squad, XYZ, blah blah, right? And so now we got off that, and now we starting getting into decent things as the second Suicide Squad, and other things such.
The
right?
Batman.
The Batman and such we was actually getting somewhere, but now I feel like based off his attack of trying to make things more production-wise, we're just going to go back to the DCEU and just try and say, let's reshoot things to try and fit
just
that.
Just because you throw a lot of money at something doesn't mean it's going to be endgame.
Yeah.
It's kind of like DC and the powers that be in this corporation don't remember that when Favreau was shopping around to do Iron Man, he was laughed out of many people.
Yeah.
Offices.
Yeah.
They're like, it's never gonna fly, it's never gonna be good.
It's like Iron Man, who's Iron Man? Why can't you do
exactly? And everyone's like, it'll never work. And that first movie was so spot on.
Yeah.
It not only made new fans, but it made the old fans very happy.
Oh yeah, not to
mention that's the only reason we could then build and build and build. And that's what Marvel did. That's that secret they're missing. They're missing the building on quality. So you can have an occasional movie that's maybe it's a B, it's not an A, it's a B, but it can handle those little dips. DC can't handle any dips because they don't have a foundation.
Yeah. Well, and not to mention, I mean, the other thing that came out of Iron Man is it jump-started Robert Downey Jr.'s career.
Oh, yeah.
When Robert Downey Jr. did Iron Man, he was coming off a low.
Yeah.
There was a low. It was like his lowest low. He was on track to rebuild his career. You know, he was on Ally McBeal. He was getting, you know, great notices. He fell off the wagon. And that crumbled.
He went to jail for a while.
Yeah, he went, But when Iron Man came out, you know, when it was being made and they were like, Robert Downey Jr.
They didn't want to insure him. They weren't sure if he was going to make it through the production.
Yep.
There were so many nightmares that they had to deal with. Yeah. That movie should have failed. Everything was stacked against it.
Yep.
Nobody thought it was going to get anywhere, and then it was exactly what the fans were looking for.
Exactly.
Stars aligned, the angels sang, the cherubs came out with the clouds, and it all sparkled.
Yep. I mean, that's the thing. It's like, also, you know, before this happened, you know, when we were in the first iterations of the DCEU, it's like, you don't have to, you know, a thing I've said is, you know, you don't have to look at something through the eyes of, okay, what do we need to fix? Like, how about look instead and say, okay, what can stick? You know, what are we working with? What works? You know, instead of saying, well, what are we going to get rid of? You know, what are we going to chop?
Yeah.
What are we going to change? Oh, Superman is lame. Let's see. What do we change about him to make him cool? It's like, no. How about, what makes, you know, we got to show people what makes Superman cool.
Yeah.
I did, you know, I was at a thing last night. I was at a meeting of the Great Basin Geeks.
Shout out.
Shout out. Yeah. Hey, great, awesome group here in Reno. Shout out to founder Michael Ford. But here's the thing. I was at the monthly meetings, and I'm talking to people, and we're talking about this. And yeah, nobody is excited. You know, nobody I spoke to was like, oh yeah, it was great to chop Batgirl. You know, we'll, you know, oh yeah, now that that's chopped, you know, maybe we can do something awesome. And then here's the other thing. You know, I was talking with somebody, and oh, you know, if you don't know what to do about a Superman movie, it's like, what I would point out to them is a scene in the miniseries All-Star Superman, where Superman, you know, is using his super hearing, and he happens to catch that there's this girl who is about to jump off a building. You know, she, for some reason, can't, you know, her appointment with her psychiatrist is not, you know, he's not there. Mm-hmm. And she's about ready to jump off a building. And Superman just comes and goes, you're not, you know, you haven't been forgotten. He's running late. It's going to be okay. And you just have a moment where he's embracing this girl on the side of the building and just trying to, you know, show her that it's okay. And it's like, if it was me and they were like, you know, we don't know what to do with Superman, we don't get Superman, I would take that panel, I'd blow it up to like giant poster size, and I would just point. I would be like the Ghost of Christmas Future pointing at Ebenezer Scrooge's grave. I would just be like, that.
Like, now we are getting into what's wrong with DC in general now. Because, like, look, give me one, just one company that's as big as DC, Marvel, Nintendo, whatever, right? Mm-hmm. That purposely alienates its mascot.
I think there would be people who would be like, well, you know, Superman no longer is our flagship character. You know, we're trying to focus more on a grounded characters like Batman.
And that's,
you know,
like, the problem.
This is the thing, because I know people who are comics fans who are trying to get it. Superman, I admit, can be tough. It can be tough. Part of it being that if you focus on Superman as, you know, like you have to find creative ways to showcase his character, because it can't just be him fighting, you know, it can't just be the end of Man of Steel all the time.
Yeah,
and it gets difficult because, I mean, we have somebody who at his most powerful was like, you know, taking baths in the sun.
Because, like, that's the problem. Everyone puts Superman as like just a brute, like he's
a tank, Superman. Yeah.
The one thing about Superman is this: he does the hardest things, and none of the hardest things is lifting anything.
Yeah, it's trying to be
simple. It's just trying to be the man of tomorrow, the champion of the helpless and oppressed. And no one ever wants to get that now. It's just this guy just flying around, running through buildings, and he can't be stopped besides from the Green Jolly Rancher.
Right. Yeah, we gotta have Doomsday, or we gotta have Darkseid be his enemy, or we gotta.
Like, sometimes they forget the number of decades of material they have. Now, yes, some of the stuff might not translate to modern day, but it Marvel again has shown how you can take a product that's been around for decades, sometimes almost 100 years, and they can tweak it and they can make it fit in today's world. And DC has lost that.
Well, think about the fact that the X-Men, you know, have been around since the 60s, and you know, they were back in the 60s, they were like an allegory for the African-American experience, but it's grown to include LGBTQ. Mm-hmm. It's grown to include, you know, it basically is now, this is the story of
anyone, you know, who's ever been oppressed or
exactly.
A misfit, mm-hmm. a misfit is a mutant, and we can so many of us can identify with that.
Exactly. It's, you know, that's the thing. You know, there's a reason. You know, somebody needs to take the powers that be right. and show them there's a reason why these things are decades old, almost centuries old. There's a reason why we still talk about them. You just need to tap into that, mm-hmm. and it does not require, Superman to be emo and just like I'm so alone. Why am I alone? Why does nobody love me? It doesn't require him to be emo. It doesn't it doesn't require that the character has to darken up. Mm-hmm. You need to, like somebody said, Superman, what's one of the ways you can, get him to a modern audience? Well, I don't know. Was he born on Earth? Oh, wait, no. He was born in outer space, which makes him, I don't know. What's that word again?
An immigrant. Oh, immigrant.
Okay. It's an immigrant. So there you go. Use a little bit of the immigrant story with Superman. It's like, there's things in there if you bother to pay attention, if you bother to work with it. Mm-hmm. There's places you can go. Hell, with anything. Yeah. Like, I've always said that, if you want to do... I think Green Lantern is another thing that's kind of on the chopping block or on the... We're not even... It's not even going to get to the vippity-vopping block.
You see the like space.
Yeah, no, it's... And I've always said, I mean, if you want to do, whether it's a TV show or a movie, with Green Lantern, what I would say, what's the perfect thing? We're going to look at the end of Star Wars. We're going to look at the end of Return of the Jedi. We're going to look at the end of Rogue One. Okay, you see all those little, space fighters and stuff? Okay, imagine we're going to take the space fighter out,
mm-hmm.
and we're going to insert a guy flying with a green glow. So all those laser blasts are coming from his hand. Right. Okay, we're going to take the TIE fighter out, and we're going to replace it with a guy flying around, but he has a yellow glow. And again, all the little laser blasts are coming out of his hand. It's like, there. That's where you begin.
Yeah.
Now go.
Yeah.
That's the thing. It's one of those things that, and I would stress on the fact that we, the Green Lantern Corps, this could make the, this could blow the doors off the cantina scene in Star Wars. The other thing is, what do you do? It's like, a great image that we got to have? Mogo.
Oh, yeah.
Because imagine you're watching, you're watching the scene with all the Green Lantern Corps, and then up in the heavens is a planet with a giant Green Lantern symbol. And, you just have wherever our focus character is going to be. It's like, what is that? Is that supposed to be like a Green Lantern satellite? Or, what is that? Is that supposed to be like our satellite base or something? And whoever they're talking to, Tomar Ray or something, goes, oh, no, that's Mogo. I'd introduce you, but he doesn't socialize.
You know who else doesn't socialize? We're going to have to stop socializing with the people on Subspace Radio Network, because we have to say goodbye to them. We only have an hour for this show on Subspace Radio Network. But what we're going to tell you at Subspace is go to either Florida Geek Scene, Geekcast Radio Network, iTunes, Google Play, Audible, Spreaker, Spotify, Stitcher Radio, TuneIn, iHeartRadio, most other podcast platforms, and MarkWho42.com, and look for the Mark Who 42's Universe podcast. And you can join everyone who's already listening there with more of our show after this. So we're going to say goodbye to everyone on Subspace. Isn't that sad? This is Mark Baumgarten, Vicky Jakubowski, Eduardo M. Freyre, and Zion Quiros. We'll be right back.
Don't go away. We'll be back with more Mark Who 42 after this.
Say, Jarvis, is it that time?
The house party protocol, sir?
Correct.
The Pull Bag is GCRN's comic book review and discussion-based podcast. Join me, your host, TFG and Mike, and the rest of the GCRN crew as we make our way through the comics we are reading. Inside the Pull Bag, you'll also find back-issue classics and origins episodes of how we got into comic reading. You can find the Pull Bag every Wednesday on iTunes and on www.geekcastradio.com. Make your great escape into comics and jump into the Pull Bag today.
Jarvis.
All wrapped up here, sir. Will there be anything else?
Yes, it's extra, the extra time here on the Mark Who 42's Universe podcast. Hi, I'm Mark Baumgarten. With me today are Eduardo M. Fryer and Vicky Jakubowski, and we're talking all about Discovery Networks and how we should destroy them. Well, maybe
well, no. Okay, let's be fair. The right now, our wrath is on David Zucchini.
Oh, come on. David Zagnut is really destroying everything. Yeah. Is it his fault? Is it David Zagnut Barr's fault that they are postponing and pushing back Aquaman 2 and Shazam 2? Is it his fault that they're pushing back, or is there another reason? Because I just heard they're being pushed back.
Well, there is a potential legitimate reason. So when Shazam was originally scheduled, I believe it's this Christmas season, it was going to be released around the same time as Avatar 2 and Wakanda Forever.
Okay, that makes sense.
There is a legitimate reason, except that my understanding, it's already in the can.
Yeah.
You know, do it at Thanksgiving instead of Christmas or whatever it is. Yeah. But now they're moving Shazam to March 23rd of 2023, and they're moving Aquaman to December 25th of 2023.
But isn't there a Marvel movie interfering?
There's always
Marvel movies.
My thing though with moving is that so Shazam 2. Mm-hmm. Is coming out it's going to come out now what is it, March 23rd, and it's like, it's the thing for me though is they do realize, like, somebody high up realizes that the risk here is you are gonna miss that holiday cheddar. They're gonna, because anything that comes out November, December, you've got the holiday crowds.
Yeah.
You know, you've got the people who are like, okay, I have my Christmas gifts, I need to get away from the crowds.
People will see it the second and third time because they're going to be off school. They might be off work. They might be with family who haven't seen it yet. So I can see where people go. I mean, I remember we would do that.
Yeah.
And you might see a movie a couple of times simply because, you know, there's more time to do it during the holiday season.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, exactly.
I have a question. When did you say that it was coming out in March?
March 23rd.
Okay. So it doesn't actually compete because Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania is on the 17th of February. And Guardians of the Galaxy is May 5th. So they are fit in there. They're
okay. Safe. So it was probably calculated to make, to go in between the releases.
Well, Aquaman was originally supposed to be the March 23rd, and they moved that to Christmas next year.
Yeah. Of course, I think, that'll be the holiday. That'll be the one that gets some of the holiday. The holiday cheer.
Which makes me think that they think Aquaman might get more money in general than Shazam, because Aquaman has the Jason Momoa effect.
Oh,
they're thinking, get the ladies. I also, I do find it interesting that they're not, there was some, one of the things that hasn't been talked about, with all this slash and burn, although there was like a brief mention of what happened when they did a test screening, and apparently it was positive despite everything, is the fact that we have the Flash movie pretty much done.
Yeah.
But the problem is that its main star,
they are having some difficulty.
They are having
apparently
some difficulties.
They have agreed to go to a program. One would hope that is sincere, but some of those crimes may result in they going to prison.
But they have said, they have admitted, okay, I have some mental issues I have to take care of. So I will say this, because I'm one of those that's always, one of the things that my parents instilled in me is this phrase called catch them being good. And the fact that they have, Ezra Miller, the fact that they have admitted that they have a problem, it's okay, good for you. Good for you. Now work on it. Now's the time to work on it. Get the help you need, and then come back fresh. I did hear, I have heard that Flash did get a test screening and that people responded positively. So that's cool. I wouldn't be surprised if what they do, what happens, what, the powers that be at DC do is have other people do press for it and, have Ezra go wherever he's supposed, wherever they are supposed to go to get help. But yeah, Flash and Aquaman, other than the fact that it got moved, is also another one that has been kind of been having problems because of what happened between Amber Heard and Johnny Depp.
Yes.
Heard has been, although with that one, since she's not she's not the main focus, that one's a little easy. I have heard that supposedly what they're doing is they're scaling her involvement back. Like, the character's not going to be as prominent. So, we'll
see. I did hear that too.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. And then maybe, she can, maybe afterwards they can recast.
Right.
So if we have Aquaman 3 or, Mira's supposed to show up in Justice League 2 or, or Aquaman has a cameo in, Superman. One thing actually that I have not heard of, I wonder if they're still going through with it or if they're going to nuke it, is I know that they did want to do like one or two projects with an African-American Superman. And I haven't heard anything. I don't know if it's been quietly canceled or what.
I don't know.
Because that was another topic of discussion last night when I was at the GBG meeting, is what's going to happen with that. I know that Kevin Smith, Kevin Smith, when he was talking about it, talking about his own canceled thing, and also about Batgirl, the main actress was Latina. And basically, they canceled the Latina Batgirl. And that is just bad optics. So I wonder if they haven't said anything about that project, because if it is on the chopping block, do you want to be, would you want, if you were working at Warner Brothers, would you want to be the one to announce, we're not moving forward with it? Because do you want to be the one to tell people that? Because that just seems like one of, there's a part of me that kind of wonders with, with the strategy that they're thinking of, that they're trying to go with, would they want to be like, because the other thing that's weird, this is what weirds me out, because the powers that be at, at DC Warner Brothers, when they were talking the DC EU and all that, they were before Marvel did it, with things like Multiverse of Madness, they were the ones who were talking about multiverse.
Yeah.
Especially because they, they were trying to cool off the idea that, maybe the Grant Justin, Flash will show up in movies. Oh, why can't we have, Stephen Amell as Green Arrow in the movies? it's something like, it feels to me like they, they mentioned the multiverse, but then they don't do anything with it. And this is one of the things that if you want, if you do want to have a movie featuring the African, for example, you could have the African-American Superman who's president of the United States in his world. Yeah. You can still have that. And, I know that an excuse that gets banded about is like, we don't want to confuse viewers. Okay.
Oh, please.
Well, no, but here's the thing. It's like, okay. You don't want to confuse viewers. Okay, that's fine. That does seem, like a legitimate concern. Here's what you do. Beginning of the film, you have this little title card that says, throughout the multiverse, there's the story of Superman, the alien orphan that came to Earth, in one world, he became a hero and he became the leader of a nation. Boom.
Right.
There you go. Problem solved right there from the beginning. We know that this is not, you know, this is an alternate reality. You know, it's one of those things where, you know, assume that your audience is not stupid. And, you know, just let them know that, you know, this is going to be an alternate take.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, trust your audience. You know, trust that if you give them the right amount of information, that they will be able to get it. And, you know, and also trust, like, it just flabbergasts me, you know, about the fact that, and I saw something, I don't know if it was an actual memo or something, but it was like about, oh, what do we do with our, you know, our slate of, you know, with the DC films, and how it called Batgirl derivative.
Oh, no, they did not.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if it's real. I don't know if it's real. I do remember that came out, you know, that was, somebody posted that on Facebook.
Well, I will say, know, right that on time. A lot of people who aren't as familiar with the comics don't realize the depth and breadth that you have in the comics. We were talking earlier about some of the more obscure characters and how Marvel has really, you know, excelled with that. And DC could really benefit by taking some of these more obscure characters. And like you said, there was a show in the works that, you know, do something different. And no offense, Batgirl is anything but a obscure character. She's been in many versions of Batman. Well, how can you guys even think that?
Well, and also, well, I think part of the problem is that they think, oh, it's, you know, that the knee-jerk reaction would be, oh,
it's a female Batman.
It's a female Batman, right. While ignoring, I mean, here's the thing. One of the things that, you know, that really set Barbara Gordon apart is her time as Oracle.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
That's important to the backstory, yeah.
And that also, you know, that also, like, I read, you know, I read the Batgirls comic DC has put out. Mm-hmm. And one of the things in there is that she is doing, you know, she'll dress up as Batgirl, but she'll also be there on her computer, you know, lending support to the two Batgirls that are in the field.
Yeah, I've seen that.
And that is something, I mean, she is more than, you know, she's more than just you know, a girl in a Batman suit. And that's the thing that, you know, like, I love that on the one hand you have someone calling Batgirl derivative, but then you go to the other side of the pond, so to speak, and over in Marvel you have She-Hulk, and She-Hulk has been you know, with She-Hulk, no one's saying, oh, she's just Hulk with boobs.
Right.
They embrace the fact that
they might have said that originally in the 70s.
Yeah, I think in the 70s.
But we're talking,
Savage She-Hulk. Yeah.
Yeah, but we're talking, but right now we're talking, like, right now, today, you know, 2022. That nobody is, you know, nobody is saying that.
No.
And that's the thing. And the show. Also, we've had two episodes so far, and it's embraced the fact that this is not, this is not basically the Hulk, but with long hair, lipstick, and a dress. You know, it's, you know, she's her own character. And that's the thing, you know, it's, okay, yeah, there's Kid Flash, but what about Kid Flash is different than the Flash? You know, like, figure it out. It's there. It is there if you pay attention.
Yeah.
And it's just that they don't want to pay attention. And it's just frustrating. It's, you know, Green Lantern. There are, like, something like 7 Earthbound Green Lanterns. And that's not even counting Alan Scott.
Right.
But as far as the Green Lantern Corps, because you've got Hal, you've got John, you've got Kyle, you've got Simon Baz, you've got Jessica Cruz, you've got Guy Gardner. You know, each of these has their own unique kind of feel.
Yes.
And it's like think about it this way. You can do a Green Lantern thing with Jon Stewart. Jon mm-hmm. Stewart is an ex-Marine sniper. Mm-hmm. You know, so you could throw in a little bit of, I mean, I don't know, does he have any PTSD from stuff he, you know, had to deal with?
He does. I think that was in the comic. I think he does.
Yes.
Well, in the comic, there was some PTSD dealing with something a mistake he made as a Green Lantern.
Okay, you're right. I forgot. I mean, yes.
You can, you know.
But still.
There's stuff you can play with. Yeah.
To today.
Didn't he let a whole world get destroyed?
That's what I'm talking about. Zanshi. Yeah. Oh. You're talking about Zanshi.
Yeah.
Zanshi. He thought his Green Lantern ring could take care of everything, and then it mm-hmm. turned out that the bomb he had to defuse was yellow. So it was like,
right,
wah, wah, you know.
back to Vicky, you were saying,
yeah.
I was saying that you know that's exactly that's part of the magic of what Marvel yeah. did, and you know I think it's funny. I got to tell you that one of the things that Mr. Zsasz said was that they wanted to find their own Kevin Feige. I mean, first of all, you know, there was all this talk about DC getting its own Kevin Feige. I'm like, first yep. of all, that's just silly. Don't say that, you know,
yeah.
because I mean, yes, we all know that you're trying to just copy Marvel, but get over yeah. it. And they may have one. There's a rumor going around that the producer, what is his name? Something like Dan Lin. He's done a bunch of yeah. really good things.
And I think he did the Godzilla movies.
I think so too. And that he may become their new, I would really feel bad for anyone, no matter how good they are, being titled DC's Kevin Feige. There's a title for you.
Yeah.
It's like, find what makes DC tick. And although, yes, since the beginning of the comics, the two of them have been copying off of each other. We all know that. You know, yep. you come up with this character, I come up with that character. I mean, what is it? The Mariner and Aquaman. Which one's yeah. better? There's lots of shows about yep. that.
Yep.
But just, you know, do what works for you. And if you want to borrow from Marvel, borrow the things that made them tick. Take some
or
interesting
made it work.
Risk.
Yeah. yeah.
Yes. You know, go for something obscure. Take a few interesting risks. Don't try and do tried and true, because, you know, there's only so much experimentation you can do with, say, Superman and Batman before you really tick off the fans, you know, yeah. and I really hope that with all these changes, they don't kill the sequel to the Batman, because we're all interested in seeing it.
Yep. You know, I don't know if I ever talked about this on the show, but I actually had my own like idea
Ooh.
for a DC movie. And I had this like, I've had
know.
This for years. I mean, this was even before the DCEU was a thing, but basically I had my own idea for a movie. First of all, I would name it after the comic that, you know, Batman premiered in Detective Comics.
Oh, yes.
But my idea was, and this was, I'm inspired by a brief, like a very brief moment that was in Crisis on Infinite Earths, like the comic book, not the, mm-hmm. not the CW version.
Right.
And my idea was, you take all these characters who are like detectives and, you know, similar, you know, guys like Johnny Double, Johnny Thunder, Johnny mm. Peril, you know, Christopher Chance, all these guys, and they are in a hotel for like a detectives convention or something like that. They're there for a convention. There's a murder, and you have all these guys getting together to solve it. You know, so it's basically, yeah, like what would happen if you have a huge like detectives gathering? It's kind of like Murder by Death, but not a comedy. You know,
Ooh.
You also, and then I would also throw in Ralph Dibny and Sue, and I would throw in Angel and the Ape, except what would happen is, like, you know, Ralph wouldn't be showing his powers constantly. Like, there'd be little hints that he has superpowers, you know, just like Angel and the Ape. Like, I think the ape uses telepathy or something to look normal.
Right.
So
right.
it would just look like this big guy, you know, like it would look like, you know, like like I know The Rock is already Black Adam. Yeah, you know, you'd have somebody like The Rock or maybe Vinnie Jones playing this character as a human, and there would be hints like, oh, he and Angel would get trapped in a room, and then somebody would come to rescue them. They hear all this going on, like they hear a roar and they hear stuff breaking, and when they open the door, the room is like, you know, they may catch a glimpse of like a hairy arm, but when they look, the room's destroyed. All these goons are on the floor, and the ape is just, you know, there, like kind of, you know, he's just sitting there, and he's just like, what's up with you? You know, but then for me, one of the things I would have done to kind of, you know, to kind of tie this into the greater DC and have like a fun little scene would be, you have one of these detective characters and they're talking with somebody in the hotel lobby. They're just shooting the breeze and they're just free associating as they're trying to figure out this, you know, this whole murder mystery. And, you know, so they're just talking to this person. And then the person goes, you know, those are some good theories. Have you thought about doing this, this, and this? And the detective kind of gets like this light bulb goes off in his head. And he goes, that's actually a good idea. Thanks. You know, have you ever thought of maybe doing the PI route, Mr. Wayne? Camera pans, and it's Bruce Wayne, who just has like when I first thought of this was around the time of the Nolan films, so it would have been like Christian Bale, and you know, you would have just had Bruce Wayne sitting back with like a smug, you know, with like a little smile, you know, poop eating grin on his face, and he goes, nah, I'm much too busy. So you know, you would have had that fun little cameo. And yeah, at the end, you know, the detectives and stuff that have powers, you would have had like this little thing, like, you know, somebody would be saying goodbye to Ralph and Sue, and then they'd be walking away, they'd get like a tap, you'd see a hand tapping them on the shoulder, they turn around, and you know, there's Ralph and Sue like waving at them all the way at the end of the corridor. So the guy's just like looking at his shoulder like, huh. You know, just things like that. Like, it would have been a fun little, you know, wouldn't cost that much type of film. And it still would have been DC. You know, that's the kind of thing that would be, you know, a great thing to do. Of course, I don't know if anybody would ever do a film like that. Because, you know, they'd just be like, no, you know, Batman's too great a character for us to just do a cameo. You know? Like, he should really be involved.
But I mean, yeah, I mean,
you never know. I don't know.
No.
Yeah. I'm just, at this point, I'm just, you know, that was just me, you know, that was just me, like, I don't know, you know, that was just something, that was me just, like, spitballing and trying to come up with an idea. So,
you know, it's interesting. I've been reading these articles about the Discovery Plus chief, and how he kind of went around and he met with all the people of the various sub studios that he now owns, and, you know, shaking hands and making all these promises, and then turned around and laid off 14% of HBO and HBO Max personnel to appease the shareholders. He's greenlighting some movies. Like, he doesn't understand Clint Eastwood, which I can kind of, you know, sympathize with. But he says that, you know, he's an old guy, and so what is anyone going to do with it? But then there are other movies where you've got directors and actors who are even older than Clint Eastwood, because there are a few of them left. And and then he's greenlighting those. He's going, okay, I'm going to do this. I'm not going to do that. They just greenlit a movie. Now, I love Robert De Niro. The man is amazing. He can do almost no wrong. But apparently he's going to be in a movie called Wise Guys, where he's going to play two characters. I'm kind of feeling like a repeat of Hardy's, God, why can't I think of the twins' names? The British, what is it? The Cray Brothers?
Yeah, the Cray Brothers.
Yes.
The gangsters, so, yes.
You know, but I don't know. I just... I look at some of the stuff he's doing, and you know, he actually has been quoted at saying that Marvel's just lucky because they have, and this is what he calls them, a unicorn in Kevin Feige. If they didn't have Kevin Feige, Marvel would not have done as well. Now, that may be at least partially true, but I think all the other people involved, because what Kevin did was he hired smart people.
Yeah.
He hired good people, good actors, good writers, good directors, good producers. So he might be at the very top, but he's not sitting there going, okay, I'm going to micromanage the crap out of all of you right now. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Whereas definitely. That's exactly what this head of a studio never micromanaged. It always has blown up on every studio head since the beginning of Hollywood. Do not do that. You know, oh, I did hear that Black Adam is still scheduled to be released in October, but they're not happy about it.
Interesting.
Uh-huh. I'm like, what the heck does that mean?
The Rock, Dwayne Johnson. How do you not think that that's yes. going to be a blockbuster?
Yeah, it's what?
Yes. And I don't know. It's just, I have found it quite fascinating. The things that come out, the way the people around him talk, the way that people have, I'm concerned at how much damage he is going to do before either he is kicked out and fired
right.
with a golden parachute, I'm sure, or yeah. he comes to his senses, which I don't view that
way. He's like
how much damage is he going to do?
He's like the Doctor Who showrunner who wants to put his own mark in the show, so changes yes. everything.
Yeah. Yes.
And you heard me, Chibnall. I'm talking about you. No, I'm not.
Well, I think that they already do.
I'm not. You know what? I take that back. I am not comparing Chris Chibnall to David Zaslav because Chibnall has talent.
That is true.
I will make.
Dang! Shots fired.
Zing on Zagnut, but I won't zag on Chibnall. Chibnall's not a bad guy.
You know, I don't know. I'm going to say from a artistic point of view. Now, I, of course, was an actor, so for me, it was a different, but I would not, as an actor or writer, director, or even a low-level producer, necessarily want to contract with this guy, because if he will shelve a $90 million movie of Batgirl, either because of possibly some less than stellar grading, or because it just wasn't enough money spent on a movie, which is the stupidest reason to not release a movie ever. Why would I do that? Yeah. Why would I contract with this new version of the studio? Why would I ever work for Warner Brothers or HBO Max when I know that I could go through all that work and they're going to hide it? They're not just going to not release it. They're not just going to not stream it. They're going to hide it away.
It's even worse because, okay, did anybody hear about the so-called funeral screening?
No.
So, okay. Supposedly, what I heard, you know, something that I heard is that there's going to be what's called a funeral showing of the Batgirl film.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, what's going to happen is they're going to show the movie once to the cast and crew. You know, cast and crew are going to be able to look at
it. It's not officially released.
Yeah, it's not an official release. It's the cast and crew being able to watch it, you know, being able to see how their, you know, how their baby, you know, what, you know, how their baby came
out. That would make me even more angry.
But then here's the other thing. No, here's the other thing, though. Okay. Supposedly, after this, this funeral showing,
internal showing,
it's going to be everything about it's going to be deleted.
No,
it's going to be totally wiped off the face of the earth.
At least they didn't delete the Fantastic Four movie that Corman made.
The way that this goes, apparently, again, this is, I don't know how true this is a rumor that's running around, is that they're going to just, you know, the reason that's going to be destroyed after the showing is to prove to the IRS, yeah, we're writing this off. Mm-hmm. This is not going to be shown. Wow. You know, to say, see, look, it's gone. It doesn't exist anymore. Which to me is just like, yeah, that's the thing that has me going, WTF, man.
You know, I don't want to end the show on a downer. Come up with something good.
You know what?
We're running out of time. Come up with something good.
Honestly, oh man, it's like usually condone this. If somebody could make a copy and start passing it through conventions.
Yeah.
Like, it feels like this is one of those things where it needs to be, somebody needs to somehow, like, copy it and put it, somehow circle, you know, just like the Corman Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
Just like that Justice League pilot.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I saw that. I saw that. Yeah, sure, I saw
it. You saw that. You seem a little hesitant. You seem a little...
I more than saw it. But
you more than saw it. Okay, so you own a copy, don't you?
I'm not...
Nothing happened here.
You own a copy, don't you?
So we were going to end the show on a downer. Now we're ending the show on an illegal act.
No. I've got a positive. I am positive that the shareholders who are going to be massively hurting and the board of directors of Discovery Plus are going to positively get rid of Mr. Zanzibar, and they're going to find someone better, and we're going to get our stuff back. That's what's going to happen.
Okay, and that's the up note.
Yeah. maybe the reign of Mr. Xanadu.
That's an X.
You know what, the Z sound is still there.
Yeah, yes. I am going to end the show by saying his name is David Zaslav. I'm giving him the last word, and I really shouldn't. So you know what? I'm not. Ed, final word.
Final word. I am not enjoying the reign of Mr. Zigzag. There we go.
Okay. Yeah. And Vicky?
I am looking forward to the resurgence of Warner Brothers under new management from this current new management.
And Mr. Xylophone, no, that doesn't start with a Z. That's not good.
Okay, we're kind of running out. Mr. Zookeeper.
No, I can't say Zoolander because that may be insulting Ben Stiller. I don't want to do that.
There you go.
Yeah. We're gonna end this show on the Marku42's Universe podcast. On that note,
Mr. fans of Mark Who, come up with your own Z names.
And ooh, send it.
Go through the dictionary. Go through
come
the dictionary.
Come up with a Z name for David Zaslav and send it to markwho42s.universe@gmail.com or go to Facebook on the Mark Who 42 Universe Facebook page. Like us if you haven't, and send and post what you want to call them on Twitter at Mark Who 42, Instagram at Mark Who 42. Put it there. We will announce it on our next new show with you too. I'm Mark Baumgarten. We have Vicky Jakubowski and Eduardo M. Freyre on behalf of all of us and Zion Quiros. So long. On behalf of Mark, on behalf of myself, Mark Baumgarten, Vicky Jakubowski, Eduardo M. Freyre, and even Zion Quiros, who had to leave early because he's watching the space shot. He gets to watch the Artemis. That's cool. We're here on Florida Geek Scene, Geekcast Radio Network, all the podcast platforms, including Stitcher Radio, which we just got on, and TuneIn. And of course, go to markwho42.com for all the old shows and stuff. Go to our YouTube page for tons and tons of old shows and interviews all the way back to 2013. So long, everyone.
I hear we're also available on 8-track, and you could also get us on cassette through Columbia House.
Yeah.
For only one penny, you can get 10 tapes. You can get 10 cassette tapes.
Yeah. Bye, everyone.
That's good. I love you guys.
Thanks for listening to Mark Who 42's Universe with hosts Mark Baumgarten, Eduardo M. Freyre, Zion Quiros, and Vicky Jakubowski. This program was produced and directed by Mark Baumgarten. If you'd like to get in touch with us, please go to our Facebook page or email us at markwho42s.universe@gmail.com. You can listen to old shows at our website, markwho42.com, or even our YouTube page, markwho42.
Mark Who 42's Universe, copyright 2022.